Welcome back for the fourth session of Providence's Science and Faith Symposium. In him, all things hold together, integrating knowledge, pursuing vocation, and building up the body. Today's symposium has an international feel. We welcomed Dr. Josh Reeves from Alabama this morning, and a moment ago, we hosted Dr. Nyasha Gondora from Waterloo, Ontario. In a moment, we'll be hearing from Dr. Keith Fox from England. But I'd like to invite you right now in a rather unscientific survey to enter into our poll here where you are joining the proceedings from today so we can get a sense of where people are tuning in from. So if you have a chance to click on the response, we'd love to see where you're coming from. And as you're doing that, it is my pleasure to introduce our next speaker, Dr. Keith Fox. Dr. Fox serves as professor of biochemistry at Southampton University, and until recently was director of the Faraday Institute for Science and Religion in Cambridge. Since completing his PhD in the Department of Pharmacology at Cambridge in 1980, he's gone on to publish over 200 papers and articles. His research interests concern DNA structure and its recognition, and this past year marked the publication of a book he co-authored with Alexander Massman entitled Modifying Our Genes, Theology, Science, and Playing God. In addition to his academic work, Dr. Fox is a licensed lay minister within the Church of England. He's been at the forefront of the dialogue between faith and science for many years, serving in various capacities with several leading organizations in the field. Dr. Fox's lecture today is aptly titled Living with Science and Faith, as this is what he has been doing prominently for many years. As a reminder, during the presentation, you're welcome to type your questions into the Q&A box. And then if you see a question that you really would like to hear Dr. Fox respond to, you can upvote it by clicking on the thumbs up icon. And after the talk, we'll have the time to put some of those questions to Dr. Fox. So please give a warm virtual welcome that will hopefully extend across the Atlantic to Dr. Keith Fox.
Thank you, Robert, for your warm welcome. It's a pleasure to be with you from across the other side of the Atlantic today. And what I'm going to do to you is take you through a little bit of my own journey and then raise some questions that I hope you might find helpful for you. So I'm given the title Living with Science and Faith. And as we think about, I wonder, why are we picking on scientists? Why do we not have things like this on living with accountancy or cleaning or medicine or banking or sport or even being a pastor or a missionary and faith? And I think the very fact that we need that as a title says that somehow with science and the Christian faith, we have a problem. And that's been picked up by the earlier two speakers. I very much appreciated listening to their presentations. And so I want to take you through maybe some of the problems as we talk about. I want to talk you through some of my own personal journey and what I would call my vocation as a scientist and my vocation as a Christian who I was integrated. I want to think through what sort of responses I've had over the years from academics, from students, and from the church. Some of those very positive and some we'll see not positive. And raise one or two issues of science and faith, some practical, some doctrinal and theological ones, and leave you with some questions and I hope some inspiration. So firstly, my personal journey. Now, when do you become a scientist? Is it when you're at school or college or when you get your degree or a PhD or when you become an academic? You've probably had plenty of talks from scientists who know that they'd be a scientist from the age of five onwards, as they've been intrigued by all sorts of things, looking down microscopes, looking up at the stars. Well, that was not me. I was an ordinary kid in a loving home who went to a good school. And I'm going to share with you my school report at the age of 13. You'll see that these are in the days when school reports meant something. You were given your position in the class, and there were 33 in the class, and you can see that I am not being doing very well in most of those subjects, aged at 13. And that's the sciences as well as the humanities, all of them pretty pathetic, really. And the reason for that, I think that I wasn't doing well was not because I was misbehaving, but actually I was bored. And nothing in academia, in study, really excited me at all. The words of Ecclesiastes were rather too familiar. I applied my mind to wisdom to exploit by means of wisdom all that's done under heaven. It is a worthless task that God has given to mortals to keep them occupied. And I was bored. Now, you can blame that on me. You can blame that on the people who are teaching me. For me, I want to give credit to one teacher, and I always do this in my presentations, a chemistry teacher who I have no idea about his faith background at all. But I will show you next my school report 1 year on from a chemistry teacher who inspired me that science was really interesting and that I could do it. And you'll see most of these subjects I'm doing fairly mediocre until you come down to the chemistry, where I've gone from almost bottom in the class to top of the class in the space of 12 months on the because one particular teacher inspired me. And I want to give credit to anybody who teaches science to young people. And just to sort of emphasize those things, chemistry in that the school report then says this has been a splendid term. And just to make it clear that I wasn't excellent at everything, the English teacher said, gave me a grade D. He has made no attempt at all. So that, I feel like, was my scientific background, inspiration by one teacher who taught me that chemistry in particular was fun. And then I went on to develop, and once one thing fell into place, lots of others did as well. What about my faith journey? Well, I was born into a Christian family. I was taken to church every Sunday. It wasn't something that meant a lot to me. I was very grateful that I learned the Bible stories as a young child. And of course, I went through the teenage years where everything became rather boring. And at roughly the same time as my interest in science came alive, so my Christian faith came alive through the work of a youth group in the church. So science and Christian faith came alive at the same time. So for me, I never saw a conflict. There were two aspects of my life that developed in tandem with each other. But I have to be honest, when looking back, is that they were two separate areas of my life. Did they actually integrate? I didn't see a conflict, but I didn't see them necessarily as interacting with each other. Both developed. My Christian faith grew, particularly when I was a student in Cambridge. I learned a lot about the Christian faith, about Bible studies. I learned in my time in Cambridge a lot about science. I became a biochemist and I did my PhD in pharmacology. But I have to answer then, say, looking back, were those two aspects of my life integrated together or separate ones? And we'll come back to that sort of as I go through this presentation. My research has, throughout 40 years of research, has been involved with DNA. Its structure, the things that interact with it, it is, I would want to convince you, the most fascinating molecule in the universe. You're well familiar, most people are, with the sort of overall structure, that double helix. You can see it in of course, colored cartoons, but of course it's colorless, the molecule itself. Every cell in your body has about 2 meters of DNA. It's very long and extremely thin, so it packs into those tiny cells in our body, trillions of cells in each one of our bodies. So in each one of us, if you drew the DNA molecules end to end, that's enough to reach to the sun and back probably about 100 times. And it's responsible for many things of our physiology, of our metabolism, our development. And yet it's got such a simple structure. It's a repeating polymer of those 4 units, A, G, C, and T, and yet it has incredibly profound properties and the implications of what it does. And I've spent ages looking into this. How can that repeating molecule have such a great effect on us and all other living organisms as well? And I'm not going to bore you with that this afternoon. But I will spare you with that. But it is something that I think invokes in us, as does all science, a sense of real awe. as we look at the world around us, our jaws drop, our eyes pop out, and we see amazing things in the world. And we need, I think, as Christians, not to be afraid of that. The cosmologist Carl Sagan wrote several years ago, and he's writing as an atheist. He says, how is it that hardly any major religion has looked at science and concluded this is better than we thought? The universe is much bigger than our prophets said, much grander, more subtle, more elegant. Instead, they say, no, my God is a little God, and I want him to stay that way. A religion that stressed the magnificence of the universe as revealed by modern science might be able to draw forth reserves of reverence and awe and wonder. And I want to say amen to that. The God that I believe in is one who is responsible for the whole of the magnificent universe. The more that I discover, the more I find of the wonder of what God has done. Now, the psalmist, of course, looked up at the stars and considered the heavens the work of God's fingers, the moon and the stars he set in place. And what could the psalmist see? Only what he could see with his eyes. We've already been introduced. There are billions of stars in our own galaxy, and that is one galaxy amongst billions of galaxies. We know so much more that the psalmist ever did. They looked up at the heavens. I looked down at the molecules, the atoms. And I'd want to rephrase, as I think the psalmist would have done if they could see the sorts of things that I can see as a scientist. When I consider your molecules, the work of your fingers, the DNA and the proteins which you have set in place, the cells declare the glory of God. Biology proclaims the works of his hands. It's all God's. And I want just to spend a few moments sort of reflecting on that. That God made everything and it all belongs to him. But often as we think of science and faith, we get bogged down in questions of mechanisms, in questions of purpose. But I want for just a moment to say what maybe is so obvious, but to remind ourselves that through him, all things were made, as the prologue to John's gospel says. Without him, nothing was made that has been made. All things have been created through him and for him, as the verse from Colossians says. And let's just dwell on that for a moment. So everything that came into exists for Christ. Nothing in the universe exists for its own sake. Everything, as John Piper put it very, I think, elegantly, from the bottom of the oceans to the top of the mountains, from the smallest particle to the biggest star, from the most boring, most fascinating science, from the ugliest cockroach to the most beautiful human, everything exists to make the greatness of Christ more fully known. Or to put it again, as C.S. Lewis put it, there is no sphere of human existence over which Jesus is not sovereign. There is no division between some areas which he rules and others that he does not. There is no neutral ground in the universe. Everything, every square inch, every split second is claimed by God. Or in the famous words of Abraham Kuyper, there is not a square inch in the whole domain of our human existence over which Christ, who is sovereign over all, does not cry, "This is mine." And as scientists, we have the wonder of being able to explore that universe that God has made. It belongs to him, and we are privileged for him to give us science as a gift to be able to understand something of the world that he has made. As we stare in awe at the world and at the scientific discoveries, there is sometimes a temptation to say, well, that's where God goes because I don't understand it. A God of the gaps. And I want to emphasize that much though we stand in awe of the things in science, God doesn't just plug the gaps that science can't fill. The whole of the scientific enterprise is actually based on the assumption that we can fill the gaps. We don't necessarily invoke the existence of God in a lab, but that doesn't mean that we're silent about God. It doesn't mean that science has disproved God. I like the words of the Oxford and London chemist who said, Charles Coulson, when we come to the scientifically unknown, our correct policy is not to rejoice because we found God. It is to become better scientists. There is actually no shame in a scientist saying in answer to a question, I'm just sorry, I don't know. We don't know about that at the moment, but I'm going to do what I can to find out. And that's what the scientific enterprise is all about. You see, we find God in what we know, not in what we don't know. There are many mysteries, and Scripture rejoices in those mysteries. But God also wants us to realize his presence, not in unsolved problems, but in those that are solved. And those are words of Dietrich Bonhoeffer writing. So the Bible often points to God in the things that we do understand. And the more that we understand, the more amazed we are at the world that we live in, that God has made. I have a few quotations from colleague scientists. Bob White and Dennis Alexander, who are the founders of the Faraday Institute in Cambridge, wrote in this book, Beyond Belief, "We are immensely grateful for the sheer fun of being able to study a created world that reflects God's plans and actions. The unexpected joy of suddenly understanding some small world better is hard to beat. In his goodness, God allows us to participate in his creation." And I tell this to my undergraduate students, not in quite in those words, but they're exploring the world. When they're doing research, they're finding out something that nobody in the 13.8 billion years of the whole universe has ever discovered before. This is research. Science has enabled us to see things about the wonder of the world, exploring what God has done. And that is such a privilege as a scientist to be part of that. But as a Christian, as a scientist, you can sometimes stop and wonder, where does this fit into God's plan? Where does my life fit into this? Should I really be a scientist? Are there other ways in which my Christian faith should be demonstrated in life? Should I become a pastor, a vicar, a missionary, a medic, whatever those? Sam Berry, a geneticist, who was a great Christian, put it this way. As a Christian at university, I was faced with a hierarchy of possibilities. The really holy people became missionaries. The rather holy people were ordained, and the fairly holy people became teachers. And the also-rans did all the other jobs in the world, such as being a scientist. But it was a great relief when I realized that we've all been given different talents and callings. It's our Christian vocation for some of us to be a scientist. And the things that we do in our daily work, in our daily life as scientists, are actually a form of work and a form of worship. Many of you will know the scriptures far better than me, but I'm led to believe that the Hebrew word for work can also be the same as that for worship or service. And there's a few Bible verses there which all use effectively the same root in the Hebrew word, to worship, to work. And our work, in a sense, is an act of worship to our Lord God. Francis Collins, who many of you will know, who was until recently director of the NIH, but that is, I think, scientists, believers are the most fortunate. We have the opportunity to explore the natural world at a time in history where mysteries are being revealed almost on a daily basis. We have the opportunity to perceive the unraveling of those mysteries in a special perspective that is an uncovering of God's grandeur. And these final words of his actually almost reduced me to tears when I first heard them. This is a particularly wonderful form of worship. Worship, work, overlapping with each other. The astronomer, Johannes Kepler, who was responsible for Kepler's laws that many of us had drummed into us in physics lessons in schools, also put it like this: for a long time, I wanted to become a theologian, quite common for academic people in those years. Now, he says, however, I behold how through my efforts, God is being celebrated in astronomy. And I hope and pray that through my efforts, God is being celebrated in biochemistry. I looked in the Church of England's book, The Common Worship, which gives the liturgy for many services. And I found these words under vocation. Do you believe, so far as you know in your heart, that God has called you to the office and work? Now, I'm cheating by that because I've actually left off the end of the sentence, because it specifies as a priest in his church. But I think that those of us who practice as scientists can actually put, do you believe, so far as you know in your heart, that God has called you to the office and work as a scientist and in all sorts of other professions as well? The thing is not just science, it's our daily work, our secular jobs. But somebody put it like this: we go to work, we do a good job, we try to be honest, we dash home at the end of the day to go to a prayer meeting or to involve ourselves in some church activity so that we can do something for God on that day. And we've forgotten that actually we should have been serving God, doing things for God in our daily lives. As one teacher put it, I spend an hour a week teaching Sunday school and they hold me up in front of the church to pray for me. The rest of the week, I'm a full-time teacher and the church has never prayed for me. I think that's an exaggeration because I think in home groups and small groups and fellowship groups, we do pray for each other in our daily activities. We are in danger of that, what we might call the secular sacred divide, and keeping our day-to-day lives separate from our church lives. Because there is far more to being church than attending church and serving on church committees. But ministry in the daily world is as significant as our ministry inside the church walls. And I will put that in the context, obviously, as being a scientist and as serving God in a scientific and an academic community. For science, as I said, is a gift to us. It enables us to explore God's amazing world. Words from Kepler again: the laws of nature are within the grasp of the human mind. God wanted us to recognize them by creating us after his own image so that we could share in his thoughts. It's remarkable, isn't it, that science actually works. We kind of trust it that the experiments that we do are reproducible. Einstein himself said the most incomprehensible thing about the universe is that it is comprehensible. And we believe as Christians who are scientists, the reasons it's comprehensible, the reasons there are laws is because there is a law giver. As John Polkinghorne, the late John Polkinghorne put it, belief in God renders the intelligibility of the universe itself intelligible. It says the world is shot through with signs of mind because precisely because the mind of its creator lies behind this wonderful creation. And we need, therefore, to emphasize the importance of the material world that scientists study. Christianity is probably unique amongst the world's major religions in the stress it puts on the importance of the material world. God himself became flesh and dwelt among us, giving authenticity to the material world. God pronounced that his creation was good and it was pleasing to him. And in the incarnation, it said, the word became flesh and dwelt amongst us. So a deep respect for matter is embedded in the Christian faith. And it is that that the scientist studies. Now, of course, there's claims of conflict. Here's two US writers writing in the late 19th century, Andrew Dixon White and John William Draper, claiming that there's a conflict between them and that the history of science is a means of conflict and overcoming religious bigotry. I want to tell you that that is fake news, that throughout history, science and faith have walked hand in hand. And many of the eminent scientists, I'm sure you're familiar with them, have been people of deep faith. Michael Faraday, after whom the Faraday Institute that I had the privilege of working with is named, Johannes Kepler, Robert Boyle, James Clerk Maxwell, each of those had very deep Christian faiths. And they looked in for law in nature because they believed in a law giver. And after all, we look back to some of the history of it. The Royal Society, that eminent society in the UK, declared in its constitution back in 1663 that it was to the glory of God the Creator and to the advantage of the human race. I rather like Psalm 111. It's been described as being a psalm for scientists. Praise the Lord. I will give thanks to the Lord with my whole heart in the company of the upright in the congregation. Great are the works of the Lord, studied by all who delight in them. That's me. I am one of those who studies what God has done, his works, and I delight in them. Those words are inscribed over the doorway of the old Cavendish Laboratory in Cambridge, in Latin, in a Gothic script that you probably can't read. The works of the Lord are great, sought out of all them that have pleasure therein. When the Cavendish Laboratory moved to its new site in, I think, the late 1960s, a PhD student suggested that maybe those words should again be put over the entrance to the new Cavendish laboratory. And since Cambridge students could no longer speak Latin, they're now above the Cavendish laboratory in English. The works of the Lord are great, sought out of all them that have pleasure therein. And I rather like the way in which that is phrased in the Message version. God's works are so great, worth a lifetime of study, endless enjoyment, reveling in the things that God has done. After all, Augustine said, nature is what God does. The facts of nature are simply the acts of God. So as I try and put those together, my scientific exploration and my Christian faith, how do they interact with each other? What responses have I had from other academics? I've never hidden the fact that I'm a Christian. I've put it, actually use it at the bottom of my CV, where many people put their sort of hobbies and interests. I make it quite clear, and always have done, that I'm a practicing Christian and I take my Christian faith seriously. At my interview in Southampton, which was now over 40 years ago when I was appointed to this post, the chair of the interview panel, who I did not realize at the time was a very eminent scientist and an atheist, at the end of the interview asked me, does that mean you're going to try to convert us? My response to that was, well, I take it seriously, so I think the answer to that must be yes, but I don't think you'll notice me doing it. I've had colleagues who are grateful that there is somebody around who can give students an alternative worldview to the rather hedonistic one that most students in a secular university live in. I've had comments from senior university administrators who said, well, this is a secular university. And those words actually are less frequently used. There's actually a misunderstanding of the word, what secular means. Nowadays, of course, equality, diversity, and inclusion are really important in all academic contexts. And I think as Christians, we should be proud of that, that we are too are a group of individuals who society should treasure under their equality, diversity, and inclusion. 6 or 7 years ago, I asked if I could go half-time in Southampton and spend part of my time in the Faraday Institute in Cambridge. And I was amazed that my head of department was only very enthusiastic about it. I suspect it because he meant he saves 50% of my salary. When I told that to science colleagues, I expected derision from some of them. What are you going to do? Why are you wasting part of a scientific career dealing with science and faith? And actually, the majority of them said quite the opposite. They said, well, I'm glad that somebody is doing that. And actually, some direct students to me that maybe they've got questions of meaning and faith that I can answer in ways that others can't. I'm very fortunate that my university allows me to put these things on my university website. So that is lifted straight from it, my professional contributions, as much my scientific ones as they are those in my science and faith. And remember, I'm coming from a secular university, not a Christian university. And my professional memberships are listed down there as well. So you can see that I think I've been very fortunate in the environment that I've worked in and being able to be quite openly Christian. What responses have I had from students? I'm rather saddened, actually, that quite often I get from undergraduates that they say, I didn't know that there were any Christian professors here. And I want to say to them, I could introduce you to plenty of them. I'm fearful sometimes that students grow up thinking that the Christian faith is somewhat ephemeral, and that as you grow older, well, does it become less relevant? No, I know plenty of Christian professors, most of them, to be honest, in the sciences. I know very few Christian professors in the humanities, and I think that's true across the universities in the UK. It's far more common to be a scientist Christian than it is to be a humanities Christian. I have non-Christian students come up to me in some of the lectures I give when I will tell them, no, my worldview is that of a Christian. They will say, well, I assume you can't be a Christian and a scientist, and it opens conversations. And rather sadly, though, I am aware of several examples of students who, when exposed to Christian students who, when exposed to contemporary science, because they've been led down a rather blinker view in their churches, actually lose their faith. And I'm very sad about that, and I do what I can to reverse that. I'm also saddened that on one occasion in a Christians in Science meeting, I chaired a meeting of students, and I asked them, what is the greatest problem? What's the greatest challenge to your Christian faith? Expecting them to come up with things like suffering or evolution or the responses of the new atheists. And they all of them said, the church. Think on that for a moment. And they said the reason for that is because whenever in church, somebody said, what do you do? And they say, I'm a scientist. And in particular, one of them said, I'm a plant scientist and I do genetic modification of plants. It was a conversation stopper. And they were looked at as though they really didn't have a place within the church. So I would say to you, pray for those going to university to study science. I'm sure that you do. But it's so easy to pray for those who go to Bible college, who go to train for Christian ministry, who go to be youth workers. But do we pray for those who go to university to study science? For those who become science teachers? I've already told you my immense admiration for science teachers, because one of them changed my life effectively. What about engaging with the church? I wonder what perceptions there are, the relationship between science and faith in your church and in the wider society. Is it any different? That society often is suspicious of scientists. Is the church any less suspicious? I wonder when we last heard a sermon related to science and faith, and I was delighted to see that you have that competition for preaching a sermon on science and faith. We need to be exposing things in the church. You see, many church staff, they're wonderful people. Many pastors have great skills and great callings and a vocation, but they have little or no scientific training. And sometimes we learn science subliminally in church, and we learn wrong science, not because of what is said, but because of what is not said. I remember as a young Christian, I desperately wanted to believe the right things about what God had done, about doctrine. And nobody took the time to explain, if you like, a contemporary understanding of those early chapters of Genesis, of what it means to see God as creator. And for a while, I think I began naively to understand the wrong things, not because of what I'd been taught, but because of what I'd not been taught. We need to be in church engaging with some of the ethical issues that science throws up. Genetic modification, information technology, artificial intelligence, vaccines. I think within the church too, where do scientists fit in? I admit I'm an awkward customer. Scientists can appear to be awkward. We're trained to ask questions. We're trained to ask for evidence. Not because we're trying to undermine things, because that's just the way in which we think. And in the church context, it's very easy for a scientist to use the same thing. So why do you believe that? What's the evidence for it? That's not that we don't believe, but we want evidence. That's the training that we have. For those of you who are church leaders, I wonder if somebody comes up to you and says, I just joined your church. I want to be involved. I'm a scientist. What should I do? Rather jokingly, I suspect that they probably say, would you like to join the choir? Or maybe, would you like to be the church treasurer? As I say, when did you last hear a sermon relating to science and faith? Do we interview our scientist Christians as scientists? I'm sure we learn plenty about them as Christians. Do we learn about them as scientists? We need to be honest that science raises issues for the church that we need to discuss openly. We can spend too long talking about evolution and mechanisms, about chance and death and suffering and the fall and what it means to be human. We need to at least have answers to those questions. But there are ethical questions too. I've already talked about bioethics, and that's not just medical ethics, artificial intelligence, cloning, genetic modification, human enhancements, the environment, climate change. These are things that scientists are at the forefront of at least having a scientific opinion of them. As Josh said earlier, that doesn't mean to say it's necessarily a political or a social opinion. but with the those things were maybe underpinned or influenced by the science. So why is it a problem sometimes that they're between science and faith? I think sometimes there's misunderstanding on both sides, on the limitations of science and the limitations of what Christian faith can say. And sometimes there's a mismatch between what we believe and what people think we believe. The new atheists have been very good at constructing straw men and assuming that all Christians believe rather naive things that they suspect we do. Maybe that it's a problem because we have a fear of a lack of confidence and not being able to answer questions. Many pastors, as I say, don't have a scientific background, and many scientists still say, well, there's things I don't understand. I'll do the best I can within my discipline. And sometimes we don't like ignorance. We don't like unanswered questions. And maybe we actually, to go back to where I started, we actually have a lack of appreciation of the importance of the physical world that God has made, that God doesn't just want us to escape from the physical world into a spiritual realm, but to get engaged with it and to see it as his creation. Some people might think that, well, scientific explanations diminish our sense of awe and wonder, and that explaining the way that things work it is the same as explaining it away. I challenge that. I mean, Keats said that about the rainbow. Now we know how the rainbow is formed by lights being split into its spectrum as it passes through droplets in the upper atmosphere. But that doesn't stop in any way diminish our sense of awe. And whether you understand it or not, we still look up at a rainbow and say, that's beautiful, isn't it? As we look at the mountains, we may understand geology and the way in which the mountains are formed, but yet my jaw drops when I look at a fantastic view. So God is God of the universe. Understand or know or understand what he's done, or whether I don't, it's a privilege as a scientist to be able to understand. I think sometimes we're afraid of what science might do, technology. I think I dare to say that science itself is probably usually ethically neutral. We're just finding the way that the world works. But application of science raises all sorts of problems. And I actually run a course in Southampton, which is to do with bioethics. That's within the university. It's looked at from a secular perspective. But again, I give my Christian worldview within that. We need to be understanding and engaging with those questions. And many Christian ministers don't understand the science, so can't begin to understand the application of the science. But the fact that something can be misused is not a sufficient reason for preventing its use for the greater good. That could be an unethical point of view. Fear that science might prove that our faith is wrong or misplaced, sometimes people have. Maybe if I looked too closely into it, I might come to think that I'm believing in a lie. Well, actually, if it is a lie, I want to be honest about it and say it's a lie. I don't want to believe a lie. I fervently believe that you can ask as many scientific questions about the Christian faith as you like, and it will not disprove the existence of God and of all that Christ has done. It won't necessarily prove it, but it won't disprove it either. I don't want to believe a lie. Let's delve into the truth and follow wherever it leads us, unafraid of that. You see, some people, I think, have what I would call a homeopathic version of faith. That is that less is more. That's the more you dilute something down, the more active it becomes. The less evidence you've got for something, the greater an act of faith you've got to believe it. Rather like Alice Alice Through the Looking Glass, who said that about believing impossible things before breakfast. Why, sometimes I believe as many as 6 impossible things before breakfast. And I think some people think that Christian faith is rather like that, believing impossible things. No, I think we believe possible things. We believe in things that the science has underpinned. And I do not believe that any form of science could ever undermine our Christian faith. Jennifer Wiseman, a NASA scientist, very involved with DOSA, and says, since God is responsible for all nature, there's nothing to fear in studying the details. In fact, God calls us to study his handiwork as a means of learning of God's character and his glory. God is not threatened by our scientific or our scientific discoveries. We may need to think carefully what we do with our discoveries and how we apply them, but God himself is not threatened by the way in which we discover the things that he has done in the world that he's made, the way in which it all holds together. Here's Francis Collins again. Says, shortly after becoming a Christian, I realized that there was no real conflict between belief in a creator God and using science to understand how God had done the creating. I can't imagine that science, which allows us to peer dimly into God's creation, would somehow threaten God. Here's an opportunity to understand God better and to increase our awe for what God has created. So people ask the question, does faith limit science? Does the fact that I'm a Christian mean that there are things that are off limits? There are questions that I shouldn't ask. As I say, science is about discovering how the world works, and Christian faith should have no problem with this. We are, as others have put it, thinking God's thoughts after him. As I say, Christian faith does have some things to say about how we should use that knowledge, but in finding out the wonders of the way in which God has made this world, that doesn't pose a threat at all. After all, we're both seeking after truth. There is only one truth. They're not competing truths. They may reveal different aspects of truth, but they're complementary. We shouldn't be afraid of truth. We don't want to believe in a lie. And scientists, too, have a deep sense that some things are true and others are false. I've had the privilege of being a senior editor of a major scientific journal for many years, and there is nothing sadder than the occasions when I've had to investigate incidences of scientific fraud. A scientist who has faked the data, who has constructed things that the data didn't show, and the evidence, and unearthing the evidence that they've cheated. There's nothing sadder than a scientist who tells lies about the way the world works, because they're trying to find out genuinely how the world works. There is a difference, and most scientists will acknowledge it, between truth and untruth, between reality and imagination, between fact and fantasy. And the scientist is trying to get to grips with that. You won't find a postmodernist in a scientific laboratory. We believe in truth, not something that's true for you and differently true for something else. Truth is truth is truth. So does science have limits? Can we have a complete scientific account of God without mentioning God? And I would dare to say, yes. Yes, we can have a complete scientific, physical account of the world in terms of equations and quantifying things. But that's not all that life is about. Science can answer all of life's questions, except the really interesting ones. There are boundaries to what science can do by virtue of what science does. It can't tell me how to live. It can't even tell me whether it's better to live or to die. It can't explain love or joy or peace or patience and so on, that wonderful list in Galatians. So yes, I'm deeply committed to sciences for exploring the world, but I understand that it cannot tell me everything about life. It can't tell me about purpose and meaning, and the sort of things that come from a deep study of God's word. I want to finish with just two or three more slides. One of them is a prayer that Johannes Kepler is supposed to have said, which puts science and scientists in a context and maybe avoid some of the hubris that science sometimes has. So Kepler prayed, "If I have been enticed into brashness by the wonderful beauty of thy works, if I have loved my own glory among men while advancing in work destined for thy glory, gently and mercifully pardon me. And finally, deign graciously to cause that these demonstrations may lead to thy glory, and to the salvation of souls, and nowhere be an obstacle to that. Amen. And I close with a picture of two scientists, one of whom you'll be very familiar with, you can name immediately. This is Albert Einstein. And the person alongside him, many of you may not be so familiar with. This is a Catholic priest by the name of Georges Lemaître. And Georges Lemaître effectively came up with the idea of the Big Bang before anybody else. He called it the primeval atom. He had a deep Christian faith and was a very influential scientist. And the words for that Georges Lemaître said is, there are two ways of arriving at the truth. I decided to follow them both, science and Christian faith, hand in hand, so that we can say, great are the works of the Lord, studied by all who delight in them. I've spoken for long enough. I'd be delighted to answer your questions. Thank you for listening to me for all that time. Thank you.
Everyone, please join me in thanking Dr. Keith Fox for his wonderful talk here today. Thank you.
Thank you.
So now we will dive into a time of question and answer. I'll remind everyone about the Q&A button that you see just at the bottom of your screen. You can click that and type your own question, and you can also see the questions that others have posed, and you may choose to upvote those, push them to the top of our list so that we can prioritize them for our Q&A session here today. You also should see, I believe, a poll in front of you, or the results of our poll that that Robert took earlier. So we do see that we're spread across Canada predominantly, but a few elsewhere, so that's great to see. Friends near and far.
Panelists were not allowed to vote, so I couldn't vote for the UK.
we'll add your vote in there somehow. So just before we dive into some Q&A, Dr. Fox, I just again really wanted to thank you for your talk. I'm sure we all enjoyed learning about your life, your schooling, especially at the start, sharing some of those progress and report cards. But also more importantly, learning about your faith and learning about your journey as a scientist, as a molecular DNA biochemist. You shared much wisdom on the topics of science and faith. And indeed, I agree that being a scientist is a privilege. We really do have joy as we observe the created world. Our eyes bulge and our jaws drop, just as that young child in your slide. And science really does enhance our awe of the natural world and of the creator of God. So let's dive into some question and answers, or some questions first here. So I'll ask one of the earlier ones here. So Terry asked a question in the middle of your talk, and I think you addressed it somewhat, and I'll give you an opportunity to perhaps add a little bit more to this question. So Terry asks, what is the source of the suspicion that some Christians express towards science?
I think Josh answered some of those in the talk that he gave first thing this morning. But I think some of it is that they've listened too much to the voices from outside shouting at us. There have been some very loud atheist voices who pretended that their science has led them to their atheism. I don't think that is correct. They are atheists, I respect that, but I don't think it's their science that has driven them necessarily in that direction. They come to their atheism from other perspectives. There are plenty of other atheists who don't shout loudly in the media, who respect Christians, who don't agree with us. And I think sometimes we've become too fond of the loud voices that criticizing Christians. I think also it is a question of authority, of who has authority and who do you listen to. Is it scripture? Is it the scientist? Do they have overlapping authorities? And for those who take a literal reading of the book of Genesis and say that, no, the world was created in six literal days, I respect them because they actually, their highest authority is their interpretation of those words in Genesis. And that no matter what you say, there is no way of anything overcoming that authority. And I think some Christians are fearful that science therefore has too great an authority and too great a dominion. I don't think it's anything to worry about. It's, as I say, it's telling us how the world works. It's not telling us how to behave. It's not telling us anything about how the world should be structured, about how what the meaning of life is. All of these things are well beyond the realm of science and nothing to be fearful of.
Thank you, Dr. Fox. Let's see here. The next question I'll ask is from Roger. So he says that he is a Christian and a scientist. The debate between the two occurs internally within his own mind. He mentions Big Bang, self-awareness, rather than with others. And he asks, is this the norm? I suppose more internal conflict and debate.
I think all of us have questions and doubts. There's nothing wrong with doubt. That doubt is not unbelief. So to put it, doubt is faith in two minds. And doubt resolves itself as we talk with other Christians, as we read other things that have been written. So I think it is quite right for us as a scientist. The scientist should be a skeptic, and one who's asking questions about why do I believe this? In my scientific research, I come up with a hypothesis. I come with a theory. Why do I believe that? And I want to ask questions. And I think it's exactly right that the Christian who's a scientist should do that. It's exactly the same about their faith, of wanting to ask questions. And in fact, you ask a question, actually says that somewhere there's a doubt in the back of the mind. But you resolve it. And so I think it is the norm. I think it's some people spend longer doubting than if you like coming to a firm conclusion than others. But I think all of us as humans inevitably ask questions about anything. What am I doing? Why do I believe this? Very good question. Thank you.
And thank you for that response. It actually reminds me of some of the words that you said earlier about the topics we discuss and the topics we don't, and perhaps how silence can still be a place where people learn something. And I'll continue to think about that. And I was reminded of that in this question, in your response. And it reminds me of the purpose of events like today, to actually talk and spend some purposeful time talking about science and faith, the experiences of theologians and scientists, because if we don't talk about that, if we don't ask questions, well, that silence is telling. Yeah. I'll ask a question that's been upvoted here by an anonymous attendee. So their question is related to the COVID-19 vaccines. So they say these vaccines have reportedly designed to permanently alter DNA in such a way that it causes the body to produce spike protein for the rest of one's life. And they mention a professor here, a pathologist has found that this could be causing organ failure because the immune system is now required to attack all organs where such spike protein has been found. What do you know of these risks? Perhaps you can discuss a little bit about what you know of these vaccines and their effects on DNA, your favorite molecule and the molecule I see behind you there in the room.
It is indeed, yes. I would politely say that is based on misinformation. None of the vaccines work in a variety of different ways, but none of them alter our genetic material. The AstraZeneca, I can only talk about the vaccines, of course, that are used in the UK, because they're the ones I'm familiar with. The AstraZeneca one produces the spike protein that's on the virus and causes your body to produce an immune response against that one. It's not altering the genes at all. The Pfizer vaccine and Moderna one work by... They contain the messenger RNA, which to code for that, so that it is then expressed within your cells and you then generate an immune response to it. At no point does that influence your genetic material. There are risks in vaccines. There always have been risks in vaccines. There's no greater risk in this one from what we understand than there have been in all the other ones. Now, vaccines against flu or smallpox now eradicated, or measles or mumps or whatever it might be. You are putting something into the human body to provoke an immune response. The incidence of things permanently going wrong, it's very, very, very small. Now, there are side effects. Many of them trivial. I had the AstraZeneca jab the first time too. I felt a bit flu-y for a day. I had a sore arm. But those were things that passed, and that for most people, in fact, 99.99999s after it, is actually the data. There are very few vaccines now that have been given such a massive trial, the millions of people across the globe who've experienced this, with it being recorded what any side effects might be. So this is one of the, it's not an experiment, but we have the data on this now, and the vaccines are as safe as any vaccine can be.
Excellent, agreed. I'll ask a question here from a very different angle and one that has received a few upvotes. So another anonymous attendee has asked, as a scientist, how do you reconcile miracles in Jesus being raised from the dead from your scientific perspective?
There is no scientific explanation for Jesus being raised from the dead. It's just one of those facts. The thing about science is it's to do with the reproducible. The miracle, by very definition, is not reproducible. It's perfectly possible for a God who has made the world, whose I stand in awe of, has created this amazing universe. If he's got the power to do that, then he has the power, if he chooses to intervene and work miraculously. Now, generally, he doesn't. Otherwise, we wouldn't call it a miracle. It would just be a routine, everyday occurrence. But it is quite possible for God to choose to do that, to intervene, to work against, the laws that normally operate in biology, physics, mathematics, chemistry, all that, which he's made a universe that it isn't capricious. It works according to principles, but he can quite easily step into that in a miraculous way and change things and say, actually, this time I'll do it a little differently. So I don't see there's a conflict between that. I do think, as a scientist, when there are claims of the miraculous, it is quite right for a scientist to say, show me the evidence it really was a miracle and it wasn't just a natural occurrence or a fake. The miracles that Jesus did were out in the open, that the blind man could see, the lame could walk. Everybody could see that. And I think it is quite in order for scientists to challenge some miraculous claims and say, what's the data? That's the nature of science. But yes, it is perfectly possible for miraculous to happen. And God raising Christ, that's a one-off occurrence, but it's a foretaste of what will come as God raises each of us when his kingdom is finally brought in. And we live as Christ as the first fruits of the that ultimate resurrection.
Excellent. Thank you. We probably just have time for one more question. I'll see if we can sneak another one in here. I see two questions and I'll try to merge them into one. A scientist in your position, I'm sure you've heard of intelligent design and some tough topics like evolutionary biology. Maybe you could comment on some of those as we conclude this session.
Yes, thank you. Intelligent design, I have a lot of respect for those who follow that. It's something that I gave a good deal of credence to when it first appeared. And the thing about intelligent design, for those who don't and aren't familiar with it, it is saying there are some things that are just so complicated they could not have arisen by evolutionary mechanisms. Various biochemical pathways, you can't imagine half a pathway because it does not do anything. I think, and I can respect that, and they say that is evidence of God, the intelligent designer, having done something that could not have occurred by ordinary scientific processes. I think every time, though, that that has been thrown up, science usually has come with an explanation. The bacterial flagellum is a classic example. It's a very complicated molecular motor that sits on the edge of a bacteria, and it rotates. And it's got many protein subunits. And people said, well, what if we take one of those away? It doesn't work. How could it possibly have come about? There are good scientific explanations for that. That's not to say that they're necessarily right. But I think in all of the examples that intelligent design has thrown up, science has actually been able to say, well, we have a possibility. Here is a mechanism by which this could have occurred. So I think those who follow intelligent design are well-intentioned, but I think probably they're at risk of a God of the gaps. They're actually saying, we can't explain this scientifically at the moment, so we're saying that God must have intervened. And I'm very cautious about doing that sort of thing, because science might come to fill those gaps, and then the God that they've invented has sort of disappeared in a puff of smoke. So I have a lot of respect for those who follow intelligent design. I've debated many of them on several occasions, but it's not something I personally find particularly helpful. And I don't think God needs to interfere and tinker with his creation. He set this up in such a wonderful way. That things have appeared without his necessarily having to come in to interfere. He is overall the whole of the universe, every second of every day, upholding the universe by his very power, without necessarily needing to come in and tinker in the way in which intelligent design assumes. So it's a very short answer to a very complicated question. Thank you.
And thank you for allowing me to ask you such a loaded question there. Thank you. So we are at the end of our time here. So I will ask everyone to just join me again in thanking Dr. Keith Fox for his excellent talk and responses here today. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Pleasure being with you.